great pleasure to be here. First sort of real occasion with Core and Coventry. What I'd like to do is talk about what we've been doing at Wakefin's for quite a long time now, in the context of agroforestry and sustainable agriculture in general. I hope the pictures I will have will stimulate some of you, even all of you, to come and visit us in Suffolk, and also think about possibilities of research field work in this area. So I'm going to try and cover a huge amount of ground, but nevertheless, if there's anything that you want to ask while I'm going along, please feel free to interrupt. Right. Evolution. Evolution of everything, including us, really is dependent on diversity. We need diversity within and among species to produce a diversity of ecosystems, and this guy Lobo, French Canadian, I've stolen one of his diagrams to show the sort of feedback system that operates, or is thought to operate generally, amongst the biodiversity once it develops an ecosystem, and the effect on the physical or abiotic environment in all directions. If we follow that through, then we find these kind of unifying concepts. It's not totally 100%, not everybody agrees entirely, but in general, it's thought that if you have diversity, you will be getting stability in an ecosystem, you will also get productivity. And what more could we want, really, in agriculture than stability and productivity? But of course, in agriculture, modern industrial agriculture, we've lost diversity, we're losing it hand over fist very, very fast. And of course, the only way to maintain stability and productivity is by labeling on large amounts of chemicals, huge equipment, and you know all that story, I'm sure. So let's start off with one thing that we're really trying to upset completely, and that is in modern agriculture, the sort that we see in the fields around us, we see monocultures. The world largely has adapted itself to only having monocultures on an immense field scale. No more so than in cereals, and in particular in wheat. So what we've been trying to do was a much larger background story, but I'll just try and illustrate what we're trying to do with a major project at Wakelands, and that is the development of populations of wheat by really increasing the diversity and doing things in a totally opposite way from conventional breeding. So in this table you see the 20 varieties, wheat varieties, that we started with around about the year 2000. We decided on these particular varieties because these ones here were at that time well known for very high yields, or contributing directly, or as parents in breeding programs. These ones here were all considered to be very, very high quality varieties, again, either actually or contributing in breeding programs. So what we did, this is what's called a half dial-L, we managed to get funding to do this kind of crossing procedure. So you can see, for example, with the blue ones here, we the high-yielding varieties together, and the crosses produced are called the Y crosses. Here we've got the Q crosses from intercrossing all the quality varieties, and the one that's particularly important as far as today is concerned is this lot here, where we've intercrossed all the yield and quality varieties. Now, where we change or differ from conventional breeding, if you think of a conventional breeding program, somebody, for example, might take Tanker and think, yes, if we cross that with Buchan, then those are two really good parents. We should get some really good progeny. We'll grow them out in the field, and then we'll throw away 98% and just be 2%, which look as if they are going to be the winners in 10 years' time. So that's the aim of the conventional breeding. You cross the best with the best and select the best. I mean, that's the kind of summary statement of the whole thing. That where we differ is that in this system, these three groups of crosses, we didn't do any selection ourselves at all. As the crosses, the hybrids among all these varieties, began to segregate in the F2, the F3, and so on generations, we just left, left nature to do the selection. We didn't do anything. So the whole process was much more like the way in which wheat, the other cereals, actually evolved. These cereals evolved by random crosses producing huge mixtures, very diverse mixtures, which were selected by the environment. Now, the way in which conventional breeding has been able to go ahead is, of course, because wheat is actually self-fertile. So most of the grain that's produced in a wheat crop will be, and I say most, I mean this is 99%, will be the product of selfing. So you know that every grain is going to be genetically identical to every other. In this case, what we did was to mix everything up together to allow all these segregating populations to function together as a unit, in this case, the YQ, the one we're interested in at the moment. So what we can say very almost certainly is that if you look in the field of a monoculture anywhere around as you see it, you will know that every plant's going to be identical to every other. If you look at a plot or field with our IQ population in, you know exactly the opposite, that every single plant in the field is almost certainly going to be genetically different from every other. What that leads to is the potential for these big C's. We've got more genetic capacity in the crop. There are more phenotypes and there are many more genotypes in one of these population fields or plots than in a monoculture. Because they're all different, there are lots of cases where different genotypes can complement each other. For example, there will be some that are shallow rooting, which could be useful in a relatively wet year, and others that are deep rooting, they're going to be more useful in a dry year. And lots of other complementary aspects, both above and below ground. Compensation, that means if by some chance some plants fail, say in a dry year, the shallow rooted ones might not do very well, then the deeper ones, rooted ones can complement for them. I'll compensate for them. this most important factor here, that the population is able to change, it's able to respond to the environment that it's growing in. There may be some negative effects. Competition may actually be positive in some cases, but it may also be negative. The world isn't perfect, it doesn't all go in one direction. But let me just give you one brief illustration of how this population can survive well in an environment. This photograph here is actually in a hazel alley cropping system. I'll come back to that shortly. But you see hazel hedges on either side of this cropping alley. They're running north-south, and we coppice them for wood fuel. In between the hazel, you can see these plots of wheat, which are growing very well. This photograph is taken in about June of 2013, and it's actually comparing this variety, Alchemy, which is a relatively modern winter wheat monoculture type, and the YQ, the population, composite cross-population CCP, which had both been drilled at the same time, which was just a little bit late, but just about the right time in the previous autumn. And you can see from the picture, all of the plots look really rather similar, and they're growing well. And in fact, among those plots, when we came around to harvest, the Alchemy yielded a little bit more than the population. However, close by, we had this, where it was exactly the same kind of layout with Alchemy and CCP again, but they were drilled about 10 days later, just beyond the best time for drilling in the previous autumn. And guess what? Here are the population plots looking exactly the same, in fact, yielded the same as when they were drilled earlier. These plots here, which have almost failed, that was the modern variety. For some reason, the previous autumn, they by delaying the drilling, something was wrong with the conditions. I don't know exactly what it was, but it meant that the modern variety practically failed. In fact, the yield of Alchemy in the following harvest was 20% of what it was in the other plot. The CCP was 100%. To put that into figures, this is a graph of some data showing what happened over a large number of trials. The axis, the horizontal axis, is an axis of yield variability. In other words, as the environment got more uncertain as we go along that axis, it was more difficult for wheat to grow. And under those conditions, what you see is the slope of this curve here, showing that as conditions got worse, the relative performance of the population improved relative to the parents, which are of course monocultures. So in a sense, as the going gets tough, the tough get going. Now, because of this enormous diversity that's in the population, we can really think of the YQ, which is our main population, in a sense as a toolbox. We could actually use it for all sorts of purposes. And I've just got one picture here, which I took yesterday actually, from a trial in our spring wheat. And I don't know if you can see, or I hope you can see reasonably. In this part of the panel here, this was the YQ population, the winter wheat population, sown in the spring. So there was no vernalisation, no winter cold effect to drive the plants through to flowering. Except, of course, there's diversity. You can see there are some stems, these sort of rather greyer coloured stems, which will flower. They are already starting to flower. So there's a very small proportion, of types within the YQ winter population which will grow in the spring. Now, if we allow those to flower, select them, and grow the crop on in the spring, and we keep repeating that, you then get this, which is growing next door to this one. So this is actually a spring population, which will, it's not quite as high yielding as modern spring weeds, but it's not far off. And that's just by growing the winter wheat population in the spring, selecting the plants that are successful, and you keep on selecting. Okay, so that is a first step, let's say, in trying to upset things in order to come back to towards an agriculture which is much more diverse, much more like natural systems, eco-mimicry, if you like. What we can also do, of course, is mix species. And this picture here, taken a couple of days ago, this is lentils, which you can see they're now beginning to flower. On the one side, on the left-hand side, on the right-hand side, you can see there are some straight stems sticking up through the lentils, and that's an oilseed crop called Camelina, Camelina sativa. This is an experiment that we're working on with Hopperdods, a local firm near us that we work closely with. They are concerned to try and shorten the food chain and to work with both farmers and consumers, something that we like very much. So we're working together on this. And the idea here is lentils, in fact, are a very profitable crop, grows well in this country actually, although it hasn't been growing for quite some time, and there is a high demand for it. It's also good for the land in the sense that it's a legume, so it's leaving some nitrogen in the soil for subsequent crops. One of the difficulties, slight difficulties with it, it's a rather floppy little plant. It's only growing about so high. And so it's quite difficult to harvest. You have to be very gentle with a combine harvester, otherwise you get soil in the machine, and that doesn't work at all, doesn't help at all. So, what some Austrian farmers found was that if you mix Campus oilseed crop Camelina with the lentils, the two crops don't seem to affect each other very seriously. But there is an advantage in the sense that the lentils have little hooks on the ends of the leaf stems, which will wrap around the Camelina plants and help to hold them up, so that both the drying at harvest and the harvesting itself are much easier to do. So, that's just a sort of brief introduction really to the idea that thinking about farm crops, we can do a great deal in all sorts of directions to introduce much more diversity. Course, for an organic farmer, that's particularly important in relation to the rotation, the crop rotation, to have lots of legumes for bringing nitrogen into the soil for subsequent crops. What I'm particularly interested in now is whether we can run a rotation which actually has plants that help to boost nitrogen and phosphorus and potassium. And I think it's possible we're starting one experiment in that direction very shortly. Let's think about trees now. This is all supposed to be about agroforestry, but let's think about the tree element. There's some data in the literature now which enables one to look at the simple ratio of trees to human beings at different stages in history. For most of human history, most of the time, the ratio of trees per person has been about 1.5 million, that sort of order. From the time that settled agriculture started, 12,000 years ago, and the human population started to increase more rapidly, that ratio started to fall. The fall wasn't too disastrous at that time. However, in the last 2,000 years or thereabouts, it's become ridiculously accelerated to the extent that the current figure, this was actually in 2016, so probably a bit less now, has gone down to 400 per person. Now, the scale of that drop, the rate at which it's been accelerating, I find very scary. Somebody has some data which suggests that a single tree will provide enough oxygen for a person for a year. But if there's only 400 per person, and there's lots of other beings on the planet as well, and the figure's falling, that is worrying, really worrying. So, here I think is a major answer of agroforestry, which I'm sure lots of you know about in various angles and degrees. So this, again, stressing the need for diversity within and among crops and indeed including livestock. I became interested in this in the mid-80s actually, but didn't get a chance to do anything about it practically until more or less the mid-90s. And at that stage, what I was able to do, very fortunately, my wife and I were able to do, was to buy a small farm in Suffolk, and the idea, it was about 23 hectares, and I split it up into 2 hectare blocks with different agroforestry systems on them. And the idea was, at that stage, was to compare them all to see which might be the best. And I think that we need all of them. Again, we need diversity in amongst what we're doing. So this is an aerial photograph taken, I think it was 2007, so it's much more dramatic now than then. But it hadn't struck me until I had this opportunity to go up in a light aircraft to look at it, the kind of impact that we're having on the surrounding cereal empire that we live amongst. And you can see, I've just indicated the 2 major coppice systems that we have, and what was then regarded as timber systems, but that's changing at the moment. Just to really emphasize what these things look like, This was a photograph taken, obviously from a drone, about a month ago. And this shows the willow coppice system and the layout. So, again, all of these hedges are running north-south. There's about a 12-metre cropping space between the hedges. And the main thing with willow to point out is that you can see we've been harvesting or coppicing alternate rows. In fact, we harvest each year on a two-year cycle. So what that means is that this relatively small one here and the next one over there, they were harvested last January. So what we're looking at is half a year's growth recovery from coppicing, you know, down to that sort of height of plant. A phenomenal rate of growth. These taller hedges, they were last coppiced 18 months ago, and they are due to be cut next January. The yield from these, well, both of them, you can see it both with the willow and the hazel, is extraordinary, very, very high. And I think that a major part of the reason for that is that by growing the trees in this way, they have no competition for light on the east or west side. So they're able to utilize full resources on two sides with no interference. And I think that's what helps them to really grow so fast. This particular picture was taken fairly early in the morning, so you can see the sun is over in the east and there's just a little bit of shade as the sun rises, and of course as it comes round, then later on the shade will be on the other side. I could go into a lot of detail on that, but it's quite interesting and could well be very important. So that's the tree aspect with the coppice systems. Willow harvesting every 2 years, hazel we harvest every 5 years. That sounds as if we're not getting so much from the hazel, but in fact it works out at about the same, because the willow, although it's very, very fast growing, is very soft wood. There's not a very high calorific value once that wood has dried out. The hazel, on the other hand, is much harder and a much higher calorific value. So the growth rates and the calorific values more or less balance out as far as we can see. But they are producing something of the order of 10 tonnes a hectare dry matter per year. So that's actually comparable with a modern high input wheat crop, for instance. Now, what happens between the trees? Well, at the moment, in this case, we've got barley planted on that side. The other side, we're trying to do some weed control by cultivation. But of course, what happens between all of the alleys all around the farm is our organic rotation. And I've just got a couple of slides showing what things look like at different stages. This, in the timber alleys, you can see potatoes growing very happily, and you can see different varieties with different blight resistances. Again, diversity, diversity, diversity. winter oats in these alleys. Winter oats are a very good crop for an organic farmer because they're very competitive with weeds, and that shows up in a slightly different sense here. And you can see the crop is very full right across the whole alley, from even very close this is just a more distant shot of the lentil crop growing in among the timber trees. There may be an edge effect we will see when it gets around to harvest. This is the winter wheat population growing among the trees this year. You can see down here it's a bit weedy. The reason for that is that last autumn was an absolutely awful sowing time for us. The seed was delivered late, that was something beyond our control. It went in, we didn't think the drill was actually going to get through the field at all at one stage, but anyway, it did. And now, actually, despite those weeds, the population is growing very well, and I think the yield will be fine. However, what you can see here is a patch which is all weeds, and that patch is actually where there are controlled modern winter wheat varieties, which really couldn't pack it at all in these very poor drilling conditions last autumn. We've had three modern varieties which have all effectively failed. They will produce some wheat, but not very much at all. And that's replicated over four alleys. And just in passing, the names of these wonderful modern varieties, well, one is Alchemy that we've seen before. The other two are called Revelation. And the third one is called Evolution. So there's some irony there, I think. Just a little bit of a closer look at the hazel coppice system. You can see in this case we have a double hedge. And this is a picture, of course, taken just after one row was harvested. That means that by having one row harvested and one row intact, we don't lose the shade or shelter after doing the coppice cycle. By chance, these two cut rows happen to be quite near each other, but we only take, well, we have 20 of those hazel hedges and we take four each year on this five-year cycle. This gives you an idea of the rate of recovery of the hazel compared with the willow. Not so spectacular, but nevertheless, it is very solid and produces, as you can see, plants that now have many stems to each plant. In a sense, the picture looks slightly messy, and that's part of the environment, but partly also the fact that hazels are an outcrossing crop, unlike things like cereals. So, in fact, there is genetic diversity within the hazel population anyway. And you can see, certainly even there, some are a bit taller, some are a bit smaller, some recover more quickly. There are differences in colour and all sorts of other effects. Now, I rather assume that you know what coppicing is, that is, cutting the plants regularly quite close to the ground. Now, there is another way of cutting the trees, which is pollarding, and that is, in fact, cutting the trees in this case at this sort of height, and then you get a recovery in much the same way as you do with coppice. Interestingly, this way of managing trees is was the common way of managing trees in this country and a lot of Europe certainly, right up until the end of the 19th century. I wasn't familiar with it when I started on this agroforestry experiment because there just weren't many people around to talk to who knew about tree management. However, we're now converting much more towards pollard management because that way we can produce much more material for, particularly for biofuel, which I'll come back to. The idea with both coppice and pollard is to keep the trees. I mean, if you imagine, like anything else, these plants have an S-shaped growth curve. That means to say, as time goes along, when they're very young, they don't increase in size very much from year to year. But as they gradually build up, then they accelerate. And then there's a period when they grow very, very fast, till they reach maturity. And as they get towards maturity, the growth rate really slows down. So the idea with both coppicing and pollarding is to keep the trees as far as possible in that vertical part of the growth stage so that they're going as fast as possible. They're turning sunlight into material as quickly as they can. And what we see very regularly, and it's common for all species, with a pollard, you get a lot of shoots produced as the plant recovers, and those shoots carry leaves which are always larger, more numerous, and presumably more effective than on a maturing tree. And just another example here with the small leaf lime, literally, and the pollard in trees in front of the non-pollard, but these leaves are very much larger than on the non-pollarded specimen. In particular, I'd like to concentrate slightly on the Italian alder. We have an old Italian alder shelter belt next to the dim trees. You can see there are two power lines here, and because of those power lines, we've had to keep these Italian alder pollarded regularly. And that showed us how amazing these trees are at recovery, even with regular pollarding. They're producing huge amounts of material in that stage. So, from having a sort of conventional shelter belt, what we're now doing, and you can just get an impression of that looking along there, we're taking out, we're pollarding every fifth tree every year. So we're putting this into the whole thing into a 5-year pollard cycle. And that is now proving to be more important than I'd expected because of something which I should have known about ages ago or thought about, but have only just discovered very recently, and that is this term here, ramial chipped wood, RCW. Now, what happens here, and the way it turns out, is that if you cut, in this case, the small leaf line, make a pollard, it produces, as far as the guy doing the cutting is concerned, logwood, the big pieces from the trunk of the tree, and the small branches from those larger stems. Now, if this particular picture is taken much too late in a sense, but if we pollard the tree, and at the time of pollarding, we put this material straight into a chipper, a wood chipper, while it's still green and fresh and young, what you could then do, it turns out, is to blow those chips straight into a muck spreader and put those chips out on the land, the cropping land. And that has two functions. One is as a soil conditioner, but also as a source of fertility for the next crop. This seems to me to be a really crucial sort of development that I'm totally sold on. We're going to try and do some extensive experiments on this now. And I tried to summarize the kind of thinking in this slide here. In a sense, what we're trying to do with agriculture, with the sorts of processes we've got, is to decentralize the agricultural production, to make it possible, by using lots of diversity, to grow a whole range of food crops on a small area, which is good for the farms, good for the buyer. It's also good for dealing with all sorts of biological problems. Energy is, in a somewhat parallel kind of way, rather similar, in the sense that it staggered me when I learnt the figure, but if you think about energy production from power stations, that energy that's produced has to be transmitted to where it's going to be used. And the transmission losses are phenomenal. Can be of the order of 60%, 60%. So there's a real need to do something about that. And of course, scientists, technologists are really working hard at finding ways of reducing transmission losses. But one obvious way is to have a system where you don't need to transmit the energy, where you use it where you produce it. And I think agroforestry, now, as we see this kind of potential for improved management, can do this. So what I'm suggesting, or summarizing now, is we have alley cropping in the agroforestry, which can produce diversified trees and crop rotation. So lots of different trees with different purposes and functions and then products, and similarly different crops with lots of end products. If we manage the trees as coppice and pollards, what we can then do is split off the products from both the coppice and certainly the pollards into this ramial chipped wood, which can go on the land as a soil conditioner or fertilizer, and at the same time we can use dried chips, or in fact made into, there's a process called torrefaction, of sort of heating the wood, which dries off the moisture but doesn't actually drive off the energy, if you like. That makes the wood pellets much easier and cheaper to transport because they're really energy dense. That can be used locally as a wood fuel to, in fact, produce not only heat. I mean, we've been doing this at Wakelands for about 8 or 9 years. We produce all our own central heating and hot water from these coppice, hazel and willow. But we're working now with a guy called Richard Edwards in Wales, a company called Falcon Team Energy. And what we're trying to develop with him is a small combined heat and power system. You can buy combined heat and power systems, wood fueled, off the shelf across Northern Europe, but they might cost you anything over £150,000. What we're talking about is a small unit that can go into a small agroforestry farm, which will both produce the heat for heating the house and the electricity, which could be stored, for example, in the batteries of an electric car or all sorts of other things that are coming along rapidly. So what I hope I've tried to illustrate, and there's a grip on this message that by really going for diversity in all possible shapes and forms on the farm and using trees in agroforestry systems, that we can deliver virtually everything we need locally. We can work on this decentralization of both food production and energy. If it's going to work, we need to have an appreciation of the total productivity and the environmental benefits of agroforestry. And we don't have that now, partly because we don't have as big a body of data as I'd like to see, but partly also because it's just not generally appreciated. I've put in these things here, LER, etc. LER is land equivalent ratio. Now that's a really rather simple measure, a useful one in the sense that what it says is, if we're going to have an agroforestry system where we've got trees and crops, very difficult to compare in general in terms of their productivity, but if we look at the ratio of the productivity of the trees in agroforestry against trees in a plantation, and add that to, again, the comparison of a crop growing in these alleys compared with tree alleys compared with crop growing in a large field, what's the ratio? What comes out? What we find, or what we found with the hazel and willow, where we've done most observations on this so far, is that the LER values are of the order of 1.3, 1.4. What that means, what it's saying, is that you need 1.3 or 1.4 times as much land if you grow the crops separately in order to have the same production as growing them in an agroforestry system. And I think parts of our systems have LERs which are actually considerably higher than that. But that's a thing to aim for. These two here are just hypothetical at the moment, but just the sort of thing that a number of people at Coventry already are working on, or could certainly contribute to. BER, what I'm talking about there, is biodiversity. If you think about the biodiversity, I haven't mentioned it, but the biodiversity in an agroforestry system, lots of birds, lots of butterflies, moths, voles, there's a whole range of things. And the bird count, particularly, we know, is really very high for the size of the farm compared with what goes on around. And in fact, of course, if you're standing in the middle of a 40 hectare wheat field, the only birds you hear are the ones on our farm if you're near enough to hear them. You know, there's just nothing. And similarly, WER would be water equivalent ratio. Water, the hydrological component of agroforestry systems, is really very complex, difficult to handle and work out. But all I can say very simply at the moment is that these systems work, and they work whether it's dry or wet. But maybe we can discuss that further. So as well as that appreciation, we need to have the right regulatory changes so that all of these things can be encouraged. This part of this slide was written before Brexit business. Some people are saying, well, Brexit might provide an opportunity to do more of this sort of thing, maybe it will, but Europeans in general are not going to sit still and not do anything. This I've added, yet another bit of terminology. ORC is, of course, the Organic Research Centre. AFINET, most of last week I've been involved with a number of meetings with European agroforesters in this country. And AFINET is the Agroforestry Innovation Network. It's a new organisation coming out of a large agroforestry, EU agroforestry project, and ORC in this country is responsible for organising that network. But if you're interested, if you go into the ORC website, you can find the details about the way AFINET is being organised. If we can do all of the things I've been talking about, if we're optimistic about it, we can go towards community food systems by diversifying, diversifying, diversifying. You can see it all. And that's what leads to, or can lead to, sustainability and resilience and a healthy and happy society, we hope. Not very happy at the moment, but let's see. That's one of my favourite pictures, and you can see very clearly this is the population, the YQ population, all sorts of different heads all over the place, and they're growing in